Warning, this video contains major spoilers for Life is Strange episodes 1 through 4, possibly episode 5 as well, as this contains speculation. Can it really be spoilers if it hasn't even been made yet? Anyway, if you haven't played it or aren't caught up, I highly recommend doing so before watching this, or you'll hella spoil the game for yourself. In episode 4, in the investigation stage, we as the player have access to David's creepy stalker data, which includes the GPS location data of 4 cars for approximately a 1 week period, ending on October 7, which is the day that Max gained her powers. We're also given access to Frank's drug dealing data of who he sold drugs to, when, and where. In the story of episode 4, we're supposed to figure out which of those vehicles belongs to Nathan and match it to a drug deal, and the night of the Vortex Club party that Kate was drugged at, to discover the secret location she was taken to by Nathan after the party. But there's plenty more we can do with that data, including constructing an accurate map of Arcadia Bay, and I'll guide you step by step through the logic. Here we go. First, we'll take these 4 GPS pages and highlight the locations more than one person has visited. I'm also highlighting places that only one car has been to in shades of gray to keep it less confusing with too many colors. The darkest shade is the place that the person has gone to the most, which is likely to be their own house since they go there all the time and nobody else does. Now would be a good time for us to figure out whose cars these are. The Twin Peaks license plate we have seen multiple times in the game if you paid attention, because it's on Chloe's car. Easy peasy.
That's definitely Chloe's car.
The 6 feet under plate is Nathan's. We discover through the course of the investigation we're supposed to be doing right now. The top of the lake plate we've actually seen before. It was shown in episode 2 in the ending montage, as Mr. Jefferson was talking to the principal out the window of the car before driving off. So David was investigating Mr. Jefferson. Maybe he was actually near to cracking this case. Wow. This last plate, Twilight Zone, is a doppelganger car to Nathan's, and it's possible David was researching it because he wasn't sure which car was Nathan's. We've seen the car before in the Blackwell lot, so it's likely a student or faculty member. But pretty much everyone we know is a Blackwell student or faculty member, so that really doesn't narrow it down enough for us to determine whose car it is. Whoever it is, there's likely a connection between the show Twilight Zone and the character, as there is a connection between the media referenced in the plates and the characters who own the cars in the other 3 examples. But I'm getting off topic. If we can figure out who it is, the GPS data may shine some light on that character. Now, Chloe's might be the easiest to decipher, because we know where she was at least part of the day on October 7, because we were with her. When Max exits the school after setting off the fire alarm, she gets a text from Warren. Looking at the timestamp on her phone messages, we can see when it arrived, approximately 4 p.m. At about 4 p.m., Chloe's car was at the GPS location marked in red. We just saw her in the bathroom of Blackwell, so this is almost certainly Blackwell's GPS coordinates. Also, if we look at our mystery Twilight Zone owner, they visited this location every day except Saturday and Sunday. Definitely lines up with our student faculty theory. Next, Max retrieves Warren's flash drives, meets him in the parking lot, gets attacked by Nathan, and gets rescued by Chloe, and Chloe takes us to her house. Looking at the GPS sheet, after visiting Blackwell in red, Chloe's car goes to the dark gray location, the location we said was likely her house. Looks like we're good so far. Looking at the sheet, Chloe next goes to the blue location, then back home. Replaying episode 1, we'll see that after Chloe's house, the two go to the lighthouse. So blue's the lighthouse? Well, not exactly. We see them walking to the lighthouse. so Chloe either parked somewhere nearby or walked from the house. But the blue location was visited at around 6 p.m., which is what time it appears to be, so I think it's safe to assume she drove. Also, if we cross-reference Nathan's car with the times that he did drug deals at the location marked as Beach, we'll find he visited the blue location at around those times. So I suspect the blue location is the beachside place we meet Frank at in episode 4, and Chloe and Max walk to the lighthouse from there. Looking at the Twilight Zone mystery person, we can see they've been to the beach, but the time and date don't match up with any of Frank's beach drug deals, so we can't find out who it was from that. Damn. It could mean it wasn't one of the people who were on Frank's drugs if they went to the beach Frank deals at without picking something up, but that's a bit of a stretch and not much new info, so maybe I'll drop that thread. Stupid mystery person mucking things up. Back to the sheet, we see Chloe goes home, then goes back to Blackwell to drop Max off, then goes back home. Oh no, there's still a lot of these colors we haven't identified yet. Come on, David, you could have given us one more day of reconnaissance. Oh well, let's keep picking this apart. Using a grid, we can plot all these points. Sorry about the ghetto MS Paint map. Anyway, the colored dots are the colored highlights. The black letters represent the dark gray highlights, which are likely people's houses. J for Jefferson, C for Chloe, N for Nathan, and Z for Twilight Zone. The gray letters represent miscellaneous places only the person the letter indicated has visited. Also, this black dot way down here is the barn with the secret photo studio which Nathan has visited multiple times. Notice the color we marked as the beach. Blue is the farthest west. For an Oregon location, this would make perfect sense for the beach to be on the west, and if it was on the east, I'd say we got it wrong. Awesome, checks out. Now Chloe goes both magenta and green several times throughout the week. Based on our time with her, the places she's likely to go other than Blackwell and the beach would be the junkyard and the Two Whales Diner where her mom works. Let's start with Two Whales. If we visit Two Whales, based on the sun location, we see the beach directly to the west, lighthouse to the northwest, and Blackwell to the southeast. Looking at the map, that means it can't be yellow because Blackwell is northeast of there, and it can't be magenta or gray, or the gray sea, because they're much farther from the beach. So that means the green location is almost certainly Two Whales. So the logical conclusion is that magenta is the junkyard then, right? Let's check it out. Based on the sun position, the lighthouse seems to be more or less west of the junkyard. This would put the lighthouse about here, and would be consistent with where we see it from the Two Whales. Also, magenta is more or less the most north place we have plotted, so if the lighthouse is to the west and not the northwest, the junkyard almost has to be magenta. Now yellow. Yellow's a strange one. It's a place I don't think we've seen yet, but it's a place everyone on the list has been to during this week, so it's likely a pretty public place. We can get a small bit of information out of it, though, just by looking at who went there and when. The night of the Vortex Club party, when Kate got dosed, was scheduled to take place at Blackwell Academy on October 4th at 8 p.m. We know from the story of the game that Nathan picks Kate up from the party and probably takes her to the barn photo studio after that. But if we look at his GPS for that night, we see he stopped at the yellow place on his way from the party to the barn. Why would he do that? Wouldn't he want to avoid going to a very public place with his unconscious victim in the car? In fact, if you look at the map, he literally went pretty far out of his way in order to go there, Why would he do that? Well, hold on to your hat, because it's about to get interesting. If we look at all the GPS data, we find that somebody else visited the yellow dot at nearly the same exact time as Nathan did that night. Mr. Jefferson. We know from the ending of episode 4 that Mr. Jefferson is somehow involved in Rachel Amber's murder, which we know is somehow related to the events that take place at the barn. For some reason, Nathan went out of his way to meet up with Mr. Jefferson after kidnapping Kate. Maybe Nathan picked him up and took Kate to the barn together with him. Or maybe Nathan handed off Kate to Mr. Jefferson, lending him his car so as not to carry an unconscious girl to another car. This theory is backed up by the GPS data. Look at Chloe's data. Every day ends with her being at home to sleep. Look at Twilight Zone's data. Every day ends with him or her going home to sleep. Actually, side note, this probably means Twilight Zone is faculty because students can sleep at the dorm. Booyah! Sorry, ruin the mood. Continuing on. Nathan's GPS data shows him always ending the day at either home, Blackwell, where the dorm is, except the night of the party, when it spends the night at the barn. But Mr. Jefferson's car, oh Mr. Jefferson's car, it spends every night at his house, except one. The night of the party, it spends the rest of the night at the location he met up with Nathan. Dun dun dun! Mr. Jefferson didn't return home that night because he spent all night in his photo lab taking pictures of the unconscious Kate, which he added to his collection of unconscious girl photo albums. This is backed up by Max's mentions that the equipment in the barn is even better than the equipment in Nathan's room. It totally makes sense for the professional photographer to have better gear than the photo student, even if the photo student's is Moneybags McGee. Which means Mr. Jefferson is the one targeting Victoria. Did he choose her as the winner of the Everyday Heroes contest so he could get some alone time with her, to drug her and take her to the barn? Is he planning to kill her for trying to blackmail him? Why is Nathan helping Mr. Jefferson kidnap girls? And why is the Prescott family itself that owns the barn in on it? Has Mr. Jefferson, the professional photographer, been hired or blackmailed to use that giant printer to create macabre murals for a depraved Prescott family member? Speaking of what might happen in episode 5, episode 4 ends with Chloe getting shot at the junkyard and Max getting drugged. If we look at the junkyard's location, Twilight Zone lives very close to there. It's possible Twilight Zone will hear the gunshots and come to help Max. They do sleep at their house, so that definitely puts him or her in the right place at the right time to come save the day. Well, darn. We can't end this without taking a stab at who it might be then. Okay. So far, we think it's a faculty member of Blackwell, who fits the description of Twilight Zone. We know 5 members of the faculty of Blackwell: Mr. Jefferson, Ms. Grant, the principal, aka Ray Wells, David Madsen, and the enigmatic janitor, Samuel. We know for sure it's not Mr. Jefferson or David because we already know where their houses are. That leaves Ms. Grant, the principal, and Samuel. Of the 3, I think the name Twilight Zone only fits Samuel. He seems to have a certain magical thinking, talking about spirit animals and whatnot, plus his spirit animal's a squirrel. You know, the animal that hoards nuts? What does hoarding make you think of other than a pile of junk? Another way of saying, a junkyard? Dun dun dun! The junkyard is his domain. So we started at license plates, went to GPS cords, made a map of Arcadia Bay, and somehow it all points to one thing. Samuel could very well be the savior of Max, and by extension, all of Arcadia Bay and time itself in episode 5. Move over, Link, there's a new hero of time.